City of Angkor, Khmer Empire, 1181. Jayavarman VII enters the city for the first time in a decade. He sees the smoking ruins of its palaces, the ravaged farms, the temples ransacked by the armies of the Champa. Even the great temple mountain of Angkor Wat has been defiled. He swears to rebuild the city into something greater. Yet before he can do that, this deeply Buddhist king must give up his lifelong vow of pacifism and form an army. If you walk away from this series remembering one thing, it should be that Jayavarman VII is one of history's greatest imperial rulers. The most prolific builder in Khmer history, he erected more monuments than all of his predecessors combined. In fact, he built so many temples that we don't have time to cover even half of them. Not to mention, religious policies that he enacted have repercussions that echo to this day. But ironically, this man, who is often considered the greatest Khmer emperor, supposedly didn't want the job. Jayavarman was unusual. While all other members of the royal family were Hindu, he'd been raised by his deeply Buddhist mother, which, as you can imagine, created some complications. Only one previous emperor had been a Buddhist, and while the Khmer Empire was a pluralistic, tolerant society when it came to religion, Jayavarman was a bit of a special case. See, the religious authority of the emperor came from the cult of the God King, and that was a specifically Hindu institution. So because of that, when it came time for Jayavarman to take the throne, it created an opening for his brother to launch his own bid for the title. And Jayavarman, well, he was a devout Mahayana Buddhist, one who believed in nonviolence and that he had a duty to alleviate suffering. He wasn't going to raise an army and kill anyone, much less his own brother. So when the succession crisis threatened to plunge the country into a civil war, Jayavarman supposedly did something incredible. Rather than launch a war that would kill thousands, he simply let his brother have the throne. Leaving behind his title, he went into self-imposed exile in the Kingdom of Champa in modern-day South Vietnam and immersed himself in meditation and study. As he did, the kingdom crumbled. Wars of succession diminished Khmer power, and Sir Yavaman's disastrous military campaigns against Champa, continued by his successors, finally took their toll. In retaliation for decades of conflict, a Cham fleet sailed up the Mekong and attacked Angkor through its network of rivers and canals. They sacked the great city, burning whole districts, looting its holy places, and slaying the king. And it was only then, at the age of 60, that Jayavarman came home. Looking around at his old capital, the reluctant king had a revelation. As a king, he couldn't afford holding to Buddhist nonviolence, and he could only alleviate his country's suffering one way, through war. So this pacifist old man raised a fleet and engaged the Chams on the Great Lake. He drove the invaders out, winning a string of victories unprecedented in imperial history, and he kept conquering, extending Khmer territory into Vietnam. Yet the Cham invasion had taught him a powerful lesson. Angkor had great monuments, but it was not defensible. The whole concept of the city, the reason it worked, depended on urban sprawl. This was a low-density metropolis of farmsteads and family compounds far too big to build a wall around. And all of those wide roads and canals made it very easy for invading armies to bring troops right into the city center. So he decided to build a new city center, a fitting seat for his imperial capital, and one protected by a high wall. A place where government officials, priests, and common people could shelter and weather a siege. And when he raised the wall, he erected 4 gatehouses, topped with the massive image of his own serene face. Because Jayavarman found a way around the problem of his Buddhism. Rather than become a Hindu god king, he would change the Khmer state religion to Buddhism. No other ruler could have done this, but Jayavarman had saved the empire, and his overriding concern for the common people had bought him a great deal of political leeway. In fact, it was said that the illness and pain of the people affected him more than his own. Now, that of course isn't to say he was always this benevolent ruler that he claimed to be. Like every other Khmer king, he used forced labor to build his new city. And his acts of kindness toward the common people were perhaps as much of a political tool as a sincere attempt to improve life in the empire. But whatever his motivations and methods, his city was a marvel. His new capital would come to be known as Angkor Thom, or the Great City. And inside its walls, he erected a stunning number of constructions. At its center, a great royal platform where he could review troops and conduct public religious ceremonies. He built monasteries, public buildings, and stone bridges that filled the space inside the walls. And roads leading to the new city had 121 houses with fire resting stations built every 9 miles, so travelers could cross his domain in safety and comfort. But his masterpiece, his new state temple, was the Bayan, a gravity-defying citadel. It took the Hindu temple mountain style and turned it into a masterwork of Buddhist art, completely unique in architectural history. A fusion temple that celebrated both Hindu and Buddhist styles. Like Suryavaman at Angkor Wat, he decorated his temples with bas-relief carvings, showing scenes from everyday life, military triumphs, and mythological stories. And like Suryavaman, he covered it in gold leaf. But where Angkor Wat had 5 towers, shaped like the buds of lotus flowers, Jayavarman made 52 towers, each carved with a face. In fact, the towers often had 4 faces, aligned toward cardinal directions. In all, the Bayan has over 200 images of the same visage. Jayavarman's face. Or maybe the face of the Bodhisattva of Compassion. But probably, it was both. Because like his predecessors, Jayavarman had transformed himself into a god-king, but one that resembled the serene Buddha rather than the powerful Shiva. And because it was his mother who'd brought this great change to the empire, he built a temple to honor her, Taprom, a place of meditation and learning, where images of the Buddha lined the walls. It functioned as monastery and university, and at its height, over 12,000 people lived and worked there, including 18 high priests and over 600 dancers. And a further 80,000 people lived around and supported its operations. And at its center was a carving of the Buddhist personification of wisdom, an image crafted to resemble the emperor's mother. Oh, and actually, something else cool? Taprom also has a carving of a dinosaur. Okay, I know it says in the script it's not really a dinosaur, it just looks like one. Of course, it's either a boar or a rhino, but... Sorry, Rob. How about this? They also shot Tomb Raider there! Huh? Yeah, tour guides actually call it Tomb Raider Temple now. Which, come to think of it, plays into that whole dinosaur thing pretty well. She fought a T-Rex that one time, right? Okay. What would you like me to talk about? Hospitals, got it. So in addition to these religious monuments, Jayavarman also established a free healthcare system. During this time, the Khmer Empire was renowned for its mastery of herbal medicine, not to mention growing the best medical herbs in Asia. In fact, even the Emperor of China sent scholars to Angkor so they could study Khmer techniques and purchase large amounts of what were essentially medieval pharmaceuticals. Across the Khmer Empire, any subject, regardless of their place in society or lack of wealth, could walk into one of Jayavarman's 102 hospitals and receive care from the resident midwives, bone setters, apothecaries, and exorcists. Jayavarman VII died in his 90s, hailed as the greatest ruler of the Khmer. But while his 30-year reign was a golden age, it also brought the god city of Angkor one step closer to collapse. The huge expenditures of his temples and hospitals, not just in construction, but in yearly support, would drain the empire in the long term. And his conversion of the state religion from Hinduism to Buddhism weakened the cult of the god-king, undercutting the divine mandate for imperial rule. In fact, within a generation, the Shiva-worshipping iconoclast would come to the throne and attack Jayavarman's religious reforms. Just as Jayavarman had replaced the Vishnu statues at Angkor Wat with his beloved Buddha, his successor violated the great emperor's holy sites. He took a chisel to the Buddha statues in the Bayan, whittling them down to lingas, and he ordered carvers to descend onto Prom and hack every image of the Buddha out of its walls. But you can't chisel away what people believe, and Buddhism had taken root in Angkor. Thanks to Jayavarman, Cambodia remains a Buddhist country to this day. And ironically, this act of defilement would end the period of great construction in Angkor, because the water was slowly rising around the city, and these masters of hydraulic engineering were about to drown in crisis. Special thanks to educational tier patrons Ahmed Ziad Turk and Joseph Blame.